Hey guys, Jake from 8020 Media here. Today we're going to be talking about performance modifications and upgrades for the first generation Subaru WRX. Now, when I say first generation, we're talking about the 2015 to 2021 models that use the FA20F engine, also known as the FA20DIT, which stands for direct injected turbocharged. So the FA20F is a 2-liter boxer engine or flat four that utilizes a turbocharger and direct injection. In the Subaru WRX, it produces 268 horsepower and 258 torque. Now, this technically is the fourth generation of the Subaru WRX. However, in 2015, Subaru decided to drop the Impreza word from the WRX. We're talking about the VA chassis here, and specifically the FA20F engine. So with that being said, before we go ahead and jump into the performance modifications here, let's talk a little bit about the power limits of this engine and what the safe, reliable levels are before we start needing to do serious internal and block modifications. Unfortunately, the FA20 engine has weak connecting rods, and the connecting rods are the biggest concern from a power potential and power limit standpoint. Torque tends to be the killer of the connecting rods. The safe torque levels are about 325 to 350 wheel torque, which also is gonna put you somewhere around the 325 to 350 wheel horsepower range. But it's important to understand that torque, and more specifically low end torque, are really the connecting rod killers on these FA20DIT engines. With that being said, there have been examples of people running 400 plus wheel horsepower on stock connecting rods and the stock turbocharger. There's even a dyno out there of someone who produced 450 wheel horsepower and like 415 wheel torque, and who claimed that their engine was running over 380 wheel horsepower for 1 year without any problems. However, at that point, you're really living on borrowed time. Producing those power levels for 1 year isn't really long enough for us to consider that a safe and reliable level. And there have been a number of these engines that have blown connecting rods at just about 300 wheel horsepower. So there still is some risk getting up into the threes that the connecting rods could go. Generally speaking, I would say 325 to 350 wheel torque is safe. However, so much of this really depends on your tuning and having proper tuning, because it is possible to run into issues and bend your connecting rods at 300 wheel horsepower or 300 wheel torque if you're working with custom tuning and a tuner who doesn't understand the torque needs of this platform. So a stock WRX with the FA20 is gonna dyno about 225 wheel horsepower and anywhere from 240 to 250 wheel torque. So we have about 100 wheel horsepower and maybe 75 to 100 wheel torque to be able to play with on these engines before we put ourselves into a territory that I wouldn't recommend going without upgraded connecting rods at the least. So let's go ahead and talk about the modifications that can get you those power levels. First thing, of course, is gonna be tuning. Tuning's where all the big power gains come from, and it's also gonna be the building block for all of the other modifications that we do here, really maximizing the efficiency of the engine and the turbocharger. With all of these modifications is where the big power gains come from, as well as from turning up the PSI or the boost pressure that the turbocharger is running at. The most important thing here really is working with a custom tuner who understands these platforms and understands torque management for these engines, because like I mentioned, we don't have too much room to play with. I know 100 wheel horsepower is a lot, but because these are turbocharged engines, just tuning and some basic bolt-on modifications can easily put these engines into the dangerous territory. So tuning, but more specifically custom tuning, is number one on this list. Second from there is going to be an upgraded intake. Upgrading your intake will improve airflow by about 40% over the factory intake. And what that does is help supply the turbocharger with more air. So ultimately, it's gonna improve the efficiency of the turbocharger. It's gonna help it spool faster. It's gonna give you better throttle response. And ultimately, it's gonna lead to power gains somewhere around 5 to 10 wheel horsepower when used in conjunction with proper tuning. After an intake, the next most important thing is getting air out of the engine more quickly. And so that's gonna be via upgrading the downpipe downpipe, or what's also known as the J-pipe on these FA20DIT engines. The J-pipe is the first piece of the exhaust system. It bolts directly to the turbocharger, and it houses the catalytic converter. Because it has a catalytic converter in it, what that does is create a lot of exhaust back pressure. So ultimately, this back pressure works against the turbocharger, decreasing your turbo spool, and it also creates a lot of excess heat because now the turbocharger is having to work a lot harder to produce those higher boost levels. So what's important here is upgrading this J-pipe to improve exhaust flow, which is gonna reduce back pressure, it's gonna create faster turbo spool, it's gonna reduce your EGTs and your engine temperatures, and ultimately improve the efficiency of your turbocharger, which is gonna lead to good 5 to 15 wheel horsepower and 10 to 20 wheel torque power gains. And the reason that those ranges are a little bit more broad is because you can either go with a high flow catted J-pipe that retains a catalytic converter to be emissions legal, or you can opt for a catless or race pipe style that completely deletes the catalytic converter. If you go for a high flow option, your power gains are gonna be on the lower end, whereas catless is gonna be on the higher end. Catless is better for performance, but it also is not legal from an emission standpoint. The next thing to talk about here is gonna be upgrading the intercooler. The FA20 and the WRX uses a top mount intercooler instead of using a front mount intercooler. So the intercooler actually sits on top of the engine, and the benefit of that is you don't have all of that long intercooler piping, and so the air that passes through the intercooler passes through there a lot more quickly and gets into the engine more quickly, which reduces turbo lag. However, the downside is that top mount intercoolers generally just aren't very big, especially when we're talking about a small 4-cylinder 2-liter engine, and therefore is prone to causing heat soak on these WRXs. And that heat soak can actually take power away from you. If you're doing a lot of track driving or just aggressive street driving, you can actually start losing 10, 20, 30 wheel horsepower. Basically what happens here is the intercooler is not efficient enough to be able to cool the amount of air flowing through it. So ultimately you end up sending hot air into your engine, which one isn't good for reliability, but two is also terrible for performance. So the best bet here is to upgrade the intercooler. However, you can stick with an upgraded top mount intercooler, which will still provide you good performance benefits. However, it still is just a smaller unit. For people that are pushing either serious power or that are doing a lot of track driving, it is common to do a front mount intercooler conversion, but this is a little bit less bolt-on, so to speak, because it does require some modification and a bunch of trimming of your bumper to get it to fit. Fifth on our list is fueling, and more specifically ethanol or E85 fueling. To really hit this 350 wheel horsepower number that I keep throwing out there, you're gonna need ethanol fueling to do it. Without E85 or a blend of E85, you're probably gonna be capped a little bit closer to the 320 wheel horsepower mark. E85 has a significantly higher octane rating, and so it produces a lot more power than your standard pump gas does. E85 fueling is a great free modification. However, it does require proper tuning for it, and you're also gonna need to manage your ethanol contents with the flex fuel kit. And so there are a couple things that you need to do to be able to support E85, but you can see good 10 to 15 wheel horsepower gains from E85 without the need to upgrade any fueling components. Now, the stock fueling system can't handle 100% E85. It can handle about a 30% blend, also known as running E30. That's about the max limit of the low pressure fuel pump. If you upgrade your low pressure fuel pump, you can run 100% E85. However, because of the lack of lubricity of ethanol fueling, you ultimately at some point are gonna end up sending your high pressure fuel pump out the door as well, running 100% E85. If you wanna run E50 or E60 or go 100% E85, you can get those power gains up to 30, 40 wheel horsepower. All right guys, so those are our five basic bolt-on modifications. However, there are a couple other considerations on these FA20DIT engines. So let's talk just briefly about supporting modifications. components. The first one is an electronic boost control solenoid, or a boost controller. The factory boost controller is a two-port solenoid, and ultimately what happens when you upgrade your J-pipe is you decrease all of that back pressure, which allows the turbine wheel to spin a lot more freely on the turbocharger, and ultimately you can get huge and unsafe boost fluctuations from the boost controller because it's only a two-port solenoid from the factory. So if you upgrade your J-pipe, you're gonna have to upgrade the boost control solenoid as well. What you'll wanna do here is upgrade to a three-port boost control solenoid, and that will solve all of your problems. But again, you're going to want to work with a custom tuner to really dial in this setup as well. And then the second supporting modification is going to be a charge pipe and potentially a blow-off valve. The charge pipe is made of plastic, and so once you get to about 300 wheel horsepower on these engines, the charge pipes are known to crack. So good preventative maintenance to not crack a charge pipe on the highway. Just go ahead and upgrade it ahead of time. I have one more that I do feel like I have to talk about just because it's common, popular, and recommended, and that is both EGR and TGV deletes. EGR is really more of a reliability upgrade by getting rid of all of those dirty exhaust gases that are being passed back into your engine. And TGV is a bit more of a performance upgrade because the TGV butterfly valve does create and restrict some airflow. And so you have an airflow restriction from that. So getting rid of that can improve performance by improving airflow. You can see solid kind of upper single digit power gains from doing this. The only one reason I have this at the bottom of my list is both the TGV and EGR are emission systems, and so deleting them both is technically illegal from an emission standpoint. So guys, all of these modifications that we talked about here, depending on what specifically you're running, what tuning you're running, will get you somewhere around the 300 to 350 wheel horsepower mark, which is gonna be the safe limit of these engines unless you really wanna start flirting with the potential for needing a rebuilt motor and some serious internal upgrades. Again, like I mentioned, proper tuning and torque management is the main thing here. So that's my number one takeaway and key consideration for tuning and modifying these engines. Anyways, guys, that covers it for our list of modifications and upgrades on the Subaru WRX. This only covered the FA20DIT, and so I know we have a lot of other WRX versions to cover, as well as the WRX STI. So go ahead and like this video, subscribe to our channel, and stay tuned for all the future content that we have to create on the Subaru platform.